Now you are experiencing the Brother Shrunkoff Show. Hello, my friend. You have Brother Shrunkoff today on Jackson Snyder Present. And if you're interested in Elephantine Island, this is for you. Haret's article entitled 2400-year-old Passover Letter shows evolution of Jewish ritual. Because Elephantine is still quite an enigma, we know a little bit about what happened there in 3rd and 4th century BC, but not a whole lot. It was a Jewish colony of primarily mercenaries. And we know that there was a temple to Yahweh there, but not much else. And if you look on our show earlier, you'll find a couple of episodes on Elephantine about all we could get about this particular place at this particular time. But anyway, let me go on and read this article, because it's very interesting and it gives the details. In 419 BC, as the land of ancient Egypt groaned under the Persian boot, a Yahwistic Jewish community living on an island in the middle of the Nile River celebrated Passover. And in their solitude, far away from the center of Yahwism, they may have sought counsel from Yerushalayim, from whence they received a letter ahead of the holiday, that is, the Passover letter of Elephantine. Or Elephantine, either way, I guess it's fine. It is the oldest known ex-biblical account of Passover ritual, said Professor Aaron Meyer of Bar-Ilan University, Ramat Gan, in a Zoom lecture on Sunday. He uses Zoom, too. A tattered remnant of the Passover letter from Hananiah, a high official in Jerusalem, to his brother, and the Judean soldiers on Elephantine was found over a century ago among a wealth of papyri and ostraca left by various communities living on the island. The documents date to various periods. Among them was an archive of documents from the Jewish community dating to the 5th century BC, including many legal records as well as correspondence with high officials in Yerushalayim, which lay a month away by boat and land. These papyri predated the Dead Sea Scrolls by at least 4 centuries, as Bezalel Portin, Professor Emeritus of the Hebrew University, observes in his 1968 book, Archives from Elephantine. The letter and the other previous documents written in Aramaic shed light on their lives, customs, and religious observance of the community and on the life in the Jewish garrison on Elephantine. The famous Passover letter never actually mentions the word Pesach. However, other finds on Elephantine do mention it. Also, what content we can glean from the fragmented papyrus more than 2,400 years after the event strongly suggests that interpretation, many scholars agree. It also indicates that the rituals associated with Passover in later times had not been formalized yet. This Passover letter was addressed to Jedoniah, the Jewish leader of Elephantine. The letter is incomplete. What has survived is a segment about 4.5 inches. What has survived is a segment about 4.5 inches long and just over 9 inches wide. Dated to the 5th year of King Darius II, it was discovered among the other papyri in the early 20th century by German archaeologists Otto Rubinson and Frederica Zucker. The author, Haggai Mishkov, noted in Jewish History magazine, Segula, In 2013, that the letter explicitly cites the permission of the Persian ruler to celebrate the holiday, which would have been necessary for Persian soldiers. Some suggested that Hananiah is the brother of Nehemiah, mentioned in Nehemiah 1:2, but not all agree on this, Meyer remarks. Oh, if it were so, that would be a remarkable idea. The surviving bit does not actually mention the word Pesach. Yes, we saw that before. But it does hand down instructions that smack of the holiday of unleavened bread, which we just moved out of yesterday. That was the final day of unleavened bread, and now this is Thursday, and all is well, we survived. And here is a transcription of translation. Count 14 lacunae. No, start again. Count 14 and blank. There's a hole right there. On the 14th, from the 15th day to the 21st day, observe the festival of unleavened bread. Eat unleavened bread for 7 days. Do not work on the 15th and 21st days of Nisan. Do not drink. And everything that is leavened, take into your rooms and seal up between these days. Oh, it says take the leaven into your room. Interesting. Seal it up. So in 1912, William R. Arnold of the Andover Theological Seminary wrote in the Journal of Biblical Literature these words. It is perfectly clear that we have here a letter of instruction to the Jewish community at Elephantine, with directions for the punctilious observance of a feast from the 15th to the 21st day of Nisan, which requires abstinence from labor, unquote, which the author remarks is combining the Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread, that is matzah. Hiding it from sight in the house was apparently what the biblical era Jews did with chametz instead of selling it to amiable qualifying infidels. The ban on quaffing, that is drinking, is baffling, but Arnold postulates, based on the Mishnah, that it refers to the ubiquitous Egyptian beer, which was made of fermented grain, that is, leavened with yeast, an interpretation that Porton deems plausible. What might it mean to observe Pesach on the 14th? The letter could be instructing the Jews of Elephantine to sacrifice to Yahweh, Miskov suggests. That would seemingly fly in the face of the assumption that the ritual was centralized in Yerushalayim by that time, just over 100 years before the Passover letter crawled from Yerushalayim to Elephantine in 525 BC, Persian forces led by King Cambyses II invaded and subjugated Egypt, which became part of a vast Persian empire stretching from western India to Sudan. That is, in old-time language, from Bactria to Kush. It seems the Jews were already on an Elephantine island when the Persians rolled over Egypt. At least they claim to be so in a letter they wrote later to the governor of Jerusalem on the occasion of the destruction of their temple, some years after a Passover letter. They describe how they got there, and one thing they say is, "We were here before the Persians entered Egypt." So as the Jewish community had lived under the Egyptians, so they lived under the Persians, he says. Hananiah's letter is addressed to Yadoniah, the head of the Jewish community and commander of the Jewish garrison on Elephantine. Its role was to protect the southern Egyptian border. But how or why did the letter come to pass? The origins of Passover, or Pesach in Hebrew, are shrouded in mystery. Many scholars believe that the holiday as we know it subsumed two different spring rituals in antiquity, going back over 3,000 years, which are a Pesach animal sacrifice marked by semi-nomadic Israelite herders, and Chag HaMatzot, the holiday of unleavened bread, a grain celebration by farmers, the settled segment of Israelite society. When the two holidays merged is unknown. Here's another quote from Meyer. There's also mention in 2 Chronicles, which might be a later invention, King Hezekiah celebrating Passover, in fact, celebrating Pesach Sheni, supposedly right before his reformation of the cult. Unquote. According to the biblical account, King Josiah instated a Deuteronomic reform in 622 BC based on a book of law claimed to have been found in the temple in Jerusalem, which scholars believe became the Book of Deuteronomy. Oh, I'd be interested in finding that. Andrew Carlson would really like to find that, I'm sure. Among other things, according to the biblical account, the king centralized the Passover ritual in the temple, that is the first temple, ostensibly built by King Solomon in the 10th century BC. Then, come the 7th century BC, as the second book of Kings says, and I quote, "And the king, that is Josiah, commanded all the people, saying, keep the Passover unto Yahweh thy Elohim, as it is written in the book of this covenant." 2 Kings 23:21, which stipulates that the Passover sacrifice could no longer be made locally, that is, within any of thy gates, but only at the temple. According to Deuteronomy 16:5, it says there to actually boil the lamb, not roast the lamb if you have a good translation of the Hebrew. The first temple was destroyed after Josiah's time in 586 BC by invading Babylonians led by Nebuchadnezzar II. The second temple was completed in about 515 BC. It bears adding that back in the 10th century BC, when Shlomo, or whoever built the first temple, whatever the status of Jerusalem may have been, worship was evidently not centralized. Just one example is a temple found in Matzah that dates to about the same period as the first temple, which also had a sacrificial altar. Meyer says the notion of temples outside Jerusalem existed, and almost 200 years after Josiah and a century after the second temple was built in Jerusalem by returning exiles from Babylon, animals were being sacrificed in the Elephantine Temple, according to other papyri and ostraca found on Elephantine, says Porten. That is, the place was a full-blown temple, not some little church on the corner, I can tell you that. Nor was it the only Jewish temple in ancient Egypt, where sacrifices postdated Josiah's reforms. And another temple in the Egyptian province of Onias in North Egypt, sacrifices were offered as well. Yes, they had a turnover in Jerusalem, where the Zadokite priests were exiled, and some of them went over to Egypt with the priest Onias IV, asked the Egyptian pharaoh whether he would support a Jewish temple over there in Heliopolis, I believe, and he said he would. So at one time, for about 250 years there, were two big temples going, one in Jerusalem and one in Heliopolis. Now that's not in the article. That's in my own mind. I want to tell you that. Were Jews over the ages ignoring the Josiah reform? Did it only exist in the minds of the king's pet scribes? Was the Bible text about it written later in time with only hazy memory of the Persian period? We don't know. But Porten poses a different question. Why was this temple established on Elephantine to begin with? Possibly the rationale for both temples in Egypt lies in the book of Isaiah 19:19. Of course, he suggests, in that day shall there be an altar to Yahweh in the midst of the land of Egypt, and a pillar at the border thereof to Yahweh. Yes, Isaiah 18:19. Everybody should look at that and look at current events. Continuing the quote, this verse served as a warranty for the establishment of the Onias Temple. That's the one up in North Egypt. So I assume that the same verse could have served as warranty for the establishment of the Elephantine Temple because it was on the border. Unquote. Ask when the book of Isaiah was written, he answers that we don't know. But Isaiah supposedly lived in the 8th century B.C., before the boy king Josiah arose. The temples in ancient Egypt could have been exempted from Josiah's centralization of Judaism. I might add, by the way, if you follow the content of Isaiah, you will know that Isaiah had to have lived at least 300 years, because the situations that is described in that book covered 300 years. So Isaiah, if he lived 300 years, he could have been born long before Josiah and then lived through Josiah's time for another 100 years afterwards. I think that's why scholars split Isaiah into 1st Isaiah, 2nd Isaiah, 3rd Isaiah. They think it's three different people there. Well, the Jews of Elephantine may have arrived there from Israel or wherever before the concept of centralized worship, or from communities that didn't accept the concept of centralization. I quote, it could well be that they had a tradition under which temples could be built outside Jerusalem. Nehemiah prohibited mixed marriage, but we have certificates in Elephantine documenting intermarriages. Oh, they had different customs. Of course they did. They were different countries, my friend. As some documents from Elephantine show, one of these customs may have been that the Judean community there fiercely devoted themselves to Yahweh in the temple, but at home did not cavil at having a household idol or two, like in Dan in northern Israel. Or the Bible accounts of Jerusalem's central role during the Persian period may indeed have been written later. Maybe the Elephantine documents written in real time suggest that, in contrast to canon, sacrifice and ritual were not limited to Jerusalem in the 5th century B.C. Oh, my friend, you are a genius. You can figure that out by just reading the Bible. Oh, excuse me. As Gard Granerode postulated in the Journal of Biblical Literature in 2019, perhaps the Elephantine documents better reflect the substance of Judean life at the time than biblical texts. And I quote, the documents from Elephantine have not been subject to editorial processes, such as in the case with the texts of the Hebrew Bible. Well, we're getting the source there, instead of a text that has been run over and run over and run over, and now in our country we have 500 versions of the same book, which we call the Bible, the one book, but everyone is different. However, it came to pass, Jews living some 2 centuries after Josiah on the tiny island of Elephantine, near the present-day Aswan Dam, either solicited or were handed down instructions regarding the observance of Passover, which, as said, indicates that the rituals hadn't been formalized yet. Miskov notes that instead of being solicited, the letter may have been notice from Jerusalem to hold the holiday from the 15th to the 21st of Nisan. In other words, maybe they were holding it at some other time. And we know for sure that the Onian Temple and the Jerusalem Temple were holding things at different times, because the Onian Temple kept a solar calendar, and the Jerusalem Sadducees kept a lunar calendar. That's because they were Sadducee. But although the Persian king was great and the empire waxed strong, in 410 BC, the Egyptians on Elephantine rebelled against Arsamas, the satrap of Egypt. They took this opportunity to destroy the temple to Yahu, as the Elephantinians spelled the god's name YHW. Why the Egyptians destroyed the temple is speculative. Maybe it was because they adored Qum, the ram god, who, together with his consort Satis and daughter Anuket, were responsible for the waters of the Nile, on which Egypt was utterly dependent then as now. They may have been repelled by the lamb sacrifices in the temple. I guess that's another possibility. Because we know the Egyptians then and now did not like lambs. Or maybe they did like lambs and didn't want to see them killed. 3 years later, in 407 BC, the addressee of the Passover letter, the same Elephantine Jewish leader Yadoniah, wrote to the governor of Judea, still under the Persians, seeking permission to rebuild the community's temple, which he wrote had predated the Persians and had been erected under Egyptian rule. So 2 years later, in 405 BC, the temple on Elephantine was rebuilt. The following year, the Egyptians managed to finally beat back the Persian forces and would remain in control of their own country for about half a century, during which time the Jews of Elephantine sank into obscurity.
Among the Elephantine papyrus are contracts dating from 495 to 399 BC,
Porton tells Haaretz, adding,
399 is the latest dated document.
That's all we know about that, thank you. Meyer sums it up. I think there were other types of Judaism during the Persian period. In Babylon, in Jerusalem, and on Elephantine Island, and in other places, we would have seen various weird and wonderful variations compared with the biblical text, which represents a specific worldview. Unquote. Plausibly, as Granel Road suggests, based on theophoric names in the Elephantine, even if evidence smacks of a Judean pantheon there, quote, they lived a religion that was a form of Yahwism, unquote, and they might have appreciated directives from Jerusalem, and then again they might not have. That was written by Ruth Schuster, a Haaretz correspondent, and reported to you by Bogdan G. Shrumkov of Jackson Snyder Present and the Vero Senior Hard. If you watch this on YouTube, you'll see the pictures as well. And if you do, I ask you, will you please subscribe? We are pushing toward that awesome number of 1,000 subscriptions when we can start taking off with this channel. So if you will subscribe, that will be a wonderful thing. Or if you're listening to this on Podbean, subscribe there too, and help out your poor old brother Shrumkov to get a new Cadillac.